Welcome back, folks. So here we are with the September 24 recording, and the goal for today is to finish talking about section 11.2, limits and continuity for multivariable functions. So by the end of today, we have two goals. One, we want to talk about what the word continuity means for a function of two variables. And after that, we're going to develop a few tricks, a few things that we can do to show that a limit actually does exist. And really, we're only going to have two ways that we can do that. One, using a little bit of algebra manipulation, and two, using good old-fashioned squeeze theorem from Calc 1. So let's go ahead and get started. Now, continuity, I don't have too much to say about this. We're just going to establish once and for all what this term means. And it's exactly the same, really, as it was in Calculus 1. A function xy is continuous at a point ab if the quantity that you get by approaching ab in the limit agrees with the quantity that you get by plugging that point directly into the function. Now, this statement has a couple of implications. First of all, in order to compare these two numbers, they both have to actually exist. So f of ab is defined, and the limit exists. Now, not only that, but in addition to the function being defined at the point and the limit actually existing, those two quantities have to be exactly the same. Now, in practice, this amounts to saying that the graph of f of xy doesn't have any rifts, tears, holes in the graph at the point xy. It's just a nice, smooth, uninterrupted, unbroken image behavior in the graph. Now, some general principles for continuity. All of our basic elementary types of functions, polynomial functions, exponential, trigonometric, rational, radical, and logarithmic. These are all continuous at every point in their domain. So as long as the function is defined at a point, it's automatically also continuous at that point, which is very convenient. Second, we need to establish the fact that sums, differences, and products of continuous functions are also continuous. So if you combine continuous functions in any of these ways, the result of that is automatically continuous as well. And finally, quotients of continuous functions are continuous most of the time, but of course we still can't divide by zero. So quotients of continuous functions are continuous at every point where the denominator is non-zero, so that we're not dividing by zero and breaking the universe, as they say. And that's really all that there is to say about continuity. Just a few words to establish this terminology to be used in a couple of theorems later in the class, just to make sure that our functions behave nicely enough for the theorems to apply. Now, let's get to the good stuff, and let's talk about a couple of methods that we can use to actually show that a limit does exist. We talked yesterday about, you know, we can very easily show that a limit does not exist just by using the two-path test, but to show that a limit does exist requires some trickery, and so we're going to talk about that today. Now, in order to use either of the methods that we're talking about today, you have to be somewhat lucky. So all of these examples are going to be just a little bit contrived. Determine the value of the following limit if it happens to exist. And we have the rational function, which is x squared minus 2xy plus y squared all over x squared minus y squared. So let's first of all check. Is this a rational function, polynomial, radical, that I can just plug the number into this function because of continuity, that will be the limit? Well, it is rational, but if I just plug in 1, 1 to this function, the result is undefined. So f of xy is rational, but 1, 1 here is not in the domain. So can't find limit by calculating the value that we just get by plugging in this point. Now, as an alternative technique, let's try a trick similar to what we did when we were finding limits in calculus 1 for rational functions, which is to try to simplify the rational function as much as we possibly could. Let's try to factor this rational function. Let's try to cancel any common factors, and then let's see if the result of simplification is a function that actually you can plug 1, 1 into the simplified version. So let's go ahead and let's simplify. And let's go ahead and factor the numerator. Now x squared minus 2xy plus y squared, that's one of our perfect square trinomials. And this is x minus y, x minus y. And in the denominator, x squared minus y squared, that's the difference of squares, and it can become x minus y times x plus y. And that's fantastic, because that means that we can go in and we can cancel the common factor of x minus y in the numerator and the denominator, and we're left with a new, cleaner function, x minus y, x plus y. Now, because we've eliminated the factor of x minus y in the denominator, if we now try to plug 1, 1 into our new rational function, then the function will actually be continuous at that point, because we have removed the factor which originally caused us to divide by 0. This is now continuous at 1, 1. So plug in xy equals 1, 1 to find the limit. Now, as a result of doing that, 1 minus 1 in the numerator, 1 plus 1 in the denominator, gives us 0 over a non-zero number, which simplifies to 0 itself, which is a real number. And as a result, it is the value of our limit and our final answer. So in this situation, we were able to calculate the value of the limit, which automatically shows that the limit does exist. In this special case, we were able to factor the numerator and denominator of our rational fraction. We were able to cancel out some problematic factors, which left us with a new function where we could just plug in the point 1, 1 that we were given and get a defined answer. So that is one technique that can sometimes, if you're lucky, be used to find limits and to show that they actually exist. Let's talk about an even more contrived example, which I would say is used in even fewer circumstances, but it is a very interesting argument. So here, let's determine the value of the following limit if it exists. And this time, you know, looking at this fraction, x squared plus y squared, this sum of squares, can't be factored at all. So we won't be able to rely on the same algebraic trick that we used last time. We're going to need a different trick. So here's the idea. I'm going to have a hard look at this numerator, x times y squared, and then all over x squared plus y squared. I'm going to think about that x as being multiplied by the fraction x squared plus y squared. Now I'm just going to separate them out. Now, if I think about this fraction here that I've split off, one of the interesting things about this fraction is that it's always less than 1. Let's see why. Well, y squared has always got to be less than or equal to x squared plus y squared, because x squared is positive, and so adding a positive number to y squared will give you a bigger result than what you had before. And that means if you divide y squared by this larger quantity, you're going to have something that's pretty small, less than or equal to 1. Okay, now at the same time, y squared, x squared, plus y squared, all of these fellows are positive numbers. So by combining positive numbers by addition and division, the result of that is still going to be positive as well. So this fraction here, y squared over x squared plus y squared, is squeezed between 0 and 1. Now, what happens if we multiply by x? If we multiply by x, the result is still going to be squeezed between 0 and now x times 1. Times x. Now, looking at our original limit, no matter what path we take, x is going to get closer and closer to 0. So this approaches 0. The quantity on the left is always equal to 0. And so our function is being squeezed between two quantities, both of which are going to 0. So that implies that xy squared over x squared plus y squared is approaching 0. As x and y go to 0. Why? Because of the squeeze theorem. Because this fraction was squeezed between 0 and 1, our function was squeezed between 0 and x, and we knew for sure that x was getting infinitely small over time by squeeze theorem. So just a few techniques to bear in mind. I would say personally that in terms of showing that a limit does exist, your most readily useful technique is going to be this one. Most of the time, if you are asked this question, there is some kind of algebraic simplification that can be done to factor and then reduce your fraction. However, in the case that your fraction doesn't reduce, try and find two very simple functions that you can squeeze your function between those two. Maybe you will get lucky and be able to use squeeze theorem as we did here.